You're watching General Counsel Studio, and I'm your host, Andrew Zizas. I'm joined today by Ms. Francine Katz, Vice President and General Counsel, St. Joseph's Healthcare System. Ms. Katz received her Bachelor of Science in Public Relations from the University of Florida and her Juris Doctor from Georgetown University Law Center. Prior to joining St. Joseph's, Ms. Katz served as General Counsel at St. Peter's University Hospital. She was an associate at Riker, Danzig, Shearer, Highland, and Peretti, and counsel to Wendell's, Marks, Lane, and Mittendorf. St. Joseph's healthcare system is the second largest provider of charity care in the state of New Jersey. For the third year in a row, St. Joseph's was selected by Becker's Hospital Review as one of its top-ranked 100 greatest places to work in healthcare. In 2012, St. Joseph's Regional Medical Center opened a brand new critical care tower. The tower houses new operating rooms, new critical care units, a state-of-the-art helipad, and a new emergency department with specialized sub-departments for pediatric and geriatric care. Today, Ms. Katz is here to talk to us about an interesting topic, the uniquely challenging and rewarding role of a hospital general counsel. Francine, it's so nice to have you here in General Counsel Studio. Thank you for appearing.
Great. Thank you so much for having me.
So we're here to talk about the uniquely challenging and rewarding role of a general counsel, specifically one at a hospital. So if you will, share with me your biggest single challenge as a hospital general counsel.
Well, that's a great question. I'm sure you can imagine working for an organization that's open 24/7 with one of our hospitals in the inner city. Yeah. I have many, many challenges. But one that is uniquely challenging and that really keeps me very focused right now would be healthcare reform. Mm. And what are the legal implications of healthcare reform for my hospital? And what do I need to do to best protect our two hospitals as we move forward under Obamacare?
Okay, I can appreciate how that would be most challenging. Share with me, if you will, Obamacare, PPACA, the ACA, however it's referred to, how is St. Joseph's being affected?
Well, healthcare reform is needed in this country, absolutely. And all the players really need to step up and do what they can to help. At St. Joe's, we are being affected by healthcare reform and that we are in a unique situation. One of our hospitals is in the inner city, and many of the patients that we take care of don't have the means to pay. We're the second largest provider of charity care in the state. Many of our patients are illegal immigrants. Wow. And unfortunately, by the time a lot of these patients get to us, they're very sick. Yeah. And therefore, the costs of their care are that much higher than the costs of the care that you and I might have walking into an emergency room.
So these are folks who are of limited financial means in many cases. And they're not doing the maintenance that you and
right.
I would do.
Right, so they get to us sicker. So traditionally, hospitals like ours, and we're considered a DISH hospital, a disproportionate share hospital.
DISH, D-I-S-H. Okay.
D-S-H, actually.
D-S-H.
And that's because we take care of such a large number of indigent people. So traditionally, hospitals like ours have relied on the government to be a large payer source.
Sure.
Well, under healthcare reform, the government is looking to shrink the dollars that they are spending on healthcare in this country. So as a result, there are less Medicare dollars flowing to St. Joe's and hospitals like ours. Mm. To give you some examples, Medicare now uses value-based purchasing. So what that means is that Medicare dollars are decreased if our patient satisfaction scores they're compared to other hospitals. And if our patient satisfaction scores are lower, then we receive a lower payment.
Right.
So what's challenging about that for hospitals like St. Joe's is that traditionally we do have lower patient satisfaction scores because a lot of our patients actually don't even respond to the surveys. Mm. We used to send the surveys out in the mail, and what we found is we weren't getting good response rates because patients were afraid it was a bill, so they didn't even open the mail.
Throwing them away.
Exactly.
Wow.
So we've now actually interestingly moved to telephone surveys, which is turning out to be a little bit better. We're getting a higher response rate, but we still have our challenges. So that's one way the government is looking to decrease costs. Another tenet under Obamacare is If a patient is readmitted to the hospital within 30 days of an inpatient stay, Medicare doesn't pay for the subsequent readmission.
Wow.
Yes.
Wow.
Very challenging for us because, as I said, a lot of our patients are very sick and they have many comorbidities. So they may be readmitted to the hospital just because that's the nature of who they are. And in addition, it's not even that our patients are sicker. There's just some people who, because of their disease, they do have multiple hospital admissions.
Yeah.
So it's just another squeeze on the hospitals.
Wow.
So to add insult to injury, under sequestration, the government looked to cut payments to hospitals yet again. And there is now, as of April 1st, a 2% across-the-board decrease in Medicare payments to hospitals for their patients. So interestingly, there are some managed care plans that sponsor Medicare plans. So your traditional managed care companies like United, Aetna, Horizon, they may also have Medicare plans as well. They also took a hit from the government. They're getting 2% less per capita for each member enrolled in their Medicare plans. But the government softened the blow for them and over time is giving them a 3.3% increase. I think what the government's intent was that money would be used to pay the hospitals.
Right.
But that isn't necessarily happening. Some of these managed care companies are deciding they're going to also do the 2% cut. So to me, they're ending up with a pool of money. So what's frustrating for us is that we feel that all the players in healthcare need to be making cuts and need to be doing their share. We're trying to cut costs. We're looking to the managed care plans to increase their payments to us. And so as a result, and really where I come in as general counsel, is working with our finance team and how are we going to get the managed care plans to pay more.
Yeah.
So as each of our managed care contracts come up for renegotiation, we're renegotiating and we're renegotiating strongly. And in fact, right now we've actually gone out of network with one of the major healthcare managed care companies in New Jersey because we just felt that they weren't paying us what they needed to be paying for their members who do use our hospital.
Wow.
So yeah, so it's, and I have a feeling that many hospitals, well, there are other hospitals who are doing what we're doing, and many other hospitals are going to start really fighting back with the managed care companies because we need other payment sources and we need those payment sources to step up and do their fair share.
Wow, Francine, what a complicated set of
things.
I can appreciate your efforts, your hard work, your frustration. I think a lot of people will agree with you that sequestration is an insult.
Yes. Yes, it is. In many respects.
In many respects.
I think we're all affected by it, and I just hope that the public understands how hospitals are affected by it and have a sympathetic ear.
Well, I think you're making it clear. From a personal perspective, given all these challenges, and there are many, and you've only addressed some of them here. In your role as general counsel, let me ask you, what do you find most rewarding?
Well, I'm very lucky. I find myself very lucky that here I am a practicing attorney, and I get to work in an organization that takes care of people. And it's really,
That's really nice.
Rewarding to me.
Yeah.
I love my job for many reasons. One thing I'm most proud of is that I'm a working mom. I have two boys. And I love that they understand what I do and that I get to tell them stories about how I've been able to help people at work. And I think it helps them understand why I'm working and why I'm not the mom serving lunches at school, that that's my role to help other people. And I also love that they help out too. Last year during the holidays, they came and delivered poinsettias to our patients.
Oh,
so,
nice.
So I think it's great that they get to get involved too and I get to teach them valuable lessons. I love working for a faith-based institution. What's unique for me is, as a Jewish hospital administrator working in a faith-based organization, there's so much support for the various faiths of our patients that we take care of.
Yeah.
One of my favorite and most rewarding days as a hospital administrator is that it was during Passover one year, and I got a list of our Jewish patients who were inpatients. And I walked around to wish them all a happy Passover, and I wanted to make sure that they realized there was kosher for Passover food available to them if they wanted it. So I found myself in this wonderful situation. I was in a room with an elderly Jewish patient, and the other woman that was sharing the room with her was an elderly African-American woman who had worked for a Jewish family for years and years and years as a housekeeper. The two of them sat and talked about Passover and their unique experiences. And it was just so rewarding to see. And what was especially rewarding is the elderly Jewish woman was MPO, which means that she couldn't eat because of whatever her health care issues were. But that day, she was going to be allowed to eat. And she was very observant, and she needed kosher for Passover food. So I was able to call the kitchen, and they brought up to her what was going to be available to her, so she knew that she was going to be able to eat that day.
Wow.
So it was just, it's, so for me, when I think back to law school, and I think back to what I thought it was going to be like to be an attorney, I've just been so surprised and rewarded with where my career has gone and that I get to do these great things.
Not a typical story we hear
no,
on General Counsel Studio.
I bet it's not.
I'm so glad you told me that. Let me ask you a real General Counsel question. I actually have a couple of them for you. Is the role of General Counsel today one that requires more leadership or kind of lone cowboy mentality?
Yeah, that's a great question. I would say leadership. To me, and especially at my organization where resources are tapped, the general counsel has to be part of the management team and has to be involved in the day-to-day decisions so that the general counsel can provide advice from the beginning. It's important to be a leader in your organization and not just somebody who's thought of as the lawyer.
Yeah.
You have to be thought of as somebody who's involved and committed to what the organization is all about.
So let's stay on that topic. Is the role today of general counsel, whether in a hospital or otherwise, more defensive or as it was traditionally, or is it more forward-looking?
I think it's more forward-looking. Of course, there is the defensive role.
Yeah.
Certainly, there are lawsuits that you have to deal with, and that there are issues that come up where you learn about too late, so you need to be more defensive rather than proactive. But I think it's very important to be proactive, and that's what makes a good general counsel, somebody who is part of the leadership team, being proactive, heading off issues before they turn into bigger issues, and just being there to give advice all along rather than at the end.
Okay, so today's general counsel is a leader. He or she is forward-thinking. Yet, if you talk to, let's say, uninspired executives, sometimes say, well, what's general counsel do? And you know, their attitude is, well, that's the person that handles the contracts and keeps us out of lawsuits. And I think we both agree that that's foundational.
Right.
And it is fundamental. But how much of a general counsel's time now is spent on traditional legal matters?
Right. Well, certainly, yes. My days do involve contract review, dealing with outside attorneys on the various lawsuits that we have going on. But there's so much more to it, and that's what I find so rewarding about the role as well. But obviously I'm in meetings. You're going to hear every general counsel say they're in meetings all day. But those meetings are important because we're involved with the business of the organization so that we're able to be there giving advice, being a leader. And for me as a hospital general counsel, I'm involved in patient safety initiatives, quality initiatives, HR issues. St. Joe's is an institution that provides education. We have a very strong program where we provide medical education for residents and medical students. So I'm involved with a lot of issues with the residents and the medical students. So there's just so many things that I'm involved with that are unique and are not what one would typically think of when they went to law school that they're going to be doing in their career.
In your role as general counsel at St. Joe's, are you an advisor to the management team, or are you actually part of it?
Oh, I'm part of the management team.
Really?
Absolutely,
really?
Yes. And that's what makes the job so rewarding.
That and
it's hands-on. It's hands-on, right.
Well, you know what, Francine, this is great. I have time for just one more question, if I may. You're obviously a very diligent, very forward-thinking leader, as you described. Share with me your definition, and share with the folks who are watching your definition of what makes a great general counsel. And you can't say yourself.
Thank you. So I think a great general counsel is a leader, somebody who's a trusted member of the organization and approachable. You want people that work in your organization to think they can come to you so that they can share with you any problems that they might be seeing. A great general counsel should have the trust of his or her colleagues and his or her CEO. It's important to be open and to be able to talk about issues. And really what I think is the most important attribute of a great general counsel is for general counsels to be able to say, I don't know. To be able to say, I don't know what the answer is, but I know where to go to get the answer to that problem. We have to remember we're a jack of all trades. That's why our title is General Counsel.
General Counsel.
Because we have to be there to handle everything.
Oh, that's fantastic. Francine, I have to tell you, I really enjoyed our interview today. I thank you for appearing with us on General Counsel Studio. I hope you'll accept my invitation to come back again sometime.
Absolutely. This was great. Thank you for having me.
It's been wonderful having you here. Thanks for appearing with us.
Thank you.
This is Andrew Zizas, your host at General Counsel Studio, with Francine Halushka Katz from St. Joseph's Healthcare System, saying thank you very much for watching. We'll see you again.